All right. Hi everyone, and of course, welcome to tonight's final installment of Techno-Critical Assemblies of the semester. We've had a really great fall and spring of this year, but tonight we are joined by Violet Whitney and Jared Friedman for a discussion. I think it'll be really interesting to talk to them on how data assemblies or sort of infrastructures are entangled with different types of spatial productions, or how they influence construction of actual of buildings, and how that influences our understanding of architecture in the city. So from rethinking building information systems, or modeling data, to internet data, sort of open source internet data that's shaping our cities, these emergent spatial technologies are providing new opportunities and ways of engagement in practices of both space and technology. So we're sort of interested in the dialogue between the two. So first, we have Jared. So Jared is a licensed architect and technologist. He's currently a senior technical designer at the engineering firm Walter P. Moore, and he also teaches Rethinking BIM at GSAPP. So prior to Walter P. Moore, Jared was the construction tech on the construction tech team at WeWork, where he focused on developing workflows and improved communications and sort of ways of working between design and manufacturers. And his work is really nicely focused on how the industry can use and sort of rethink these massive amounts of data that's collected in R models, R files, and how projects can be designed otherwise and delivered. And then our final speaker of the whole semester and series is Violet Whitney, and in her talk, New Spaces and New Practices in Spatial Technology. She will sort of discuss, I think super interestingly, how, again, outside sources of data like the internet is really shaping the way that we think about space and how it's being designed in cities. But Violet is teaching at GSAPP. She teaches urban data analytics and tangible computing courses. And she is also an advisor to many different programs, I think specifically including hybrid pedagogy, right, of this year, which is so hugely influential. She's founded the Delve product at Sidewalk Labs. So she's sort of applying her knowledge in architecture and spatial data as a senior product manager, and she co-leads Architechies NYC, a network which brings together architects and technologists in urban tech. So I'm sure some of you guys specifically are interested in that. So we're really excited to hear from both Jared and Violet, and we'll start with Jared tonight.
Great, thank you for the introduction, and thanks to the brave souls that showed up. I know it's a finals week for you guys, so thank you guys. All right, so I'll just jump into it. Let me share my screen, move some windows around. All right, so kind of the key question I wanted to, and I'll try to put a timer here, so I try to remember, but if I go over 20 minutes, just someone yell at me. But the key question I wanted to try to unpack a little bit, and you know, in 20 minutes, we're not going to totally unpack it, but I'll show a couple examples that try to get at it, is how can we leverage data to broaden the scope of architecture? And kind of really what I'm getting at with this is that we really need to, as an industry, stop thinking about architecture as kind of like we just provide a service that provides drawings to build buildings. It's, you know, if we continue to think that way, we're not going to exist in 10 years. So really thinking about how we can leverage all of this valuable data that we have access to and that we are producing already to expand our scope. There we go. So I'm going to kind of break this down into two sort of parts, authoring data. So really kind of about the production of data and then delivering with data. So really kind of more on the consumption side and different ways of communicating. So with authoring data, you know, to design the built environment that we want to exist, we need to have a say in the systems with which we design. So what do I mean by that? A big portion of that, when thinking about kind of the systems in which we design, not all of it, but a big chunk of it has to do with the software that we're using and the databases that we're using. And, you know, if we kind of just sit back and accept whatever kind of, you know, the big software companies are going to give us, there, you know, we're going to really be struggling, continue to struggle. So one of the examples I kind of wanted to talk about a little bit was how, so at Walter P. Moore, which like was mentioned, where, so I, just a little bit of background since some of you might not know. So Walter P. Moore is a kind of a large 700 plus person engineering firm that has, you know, infrastructure, structural engineering, which is kind of where I live in the structural engineering world. Within structures, there's kind of like enclosures and parking and like structures and and construction engineering as well. So there's kind of a few different areas, but the main one I'll kind of talk to, the main ones I'll talk to are structural engineering and enclosures engineering. And so a lot of what we've been doing, what I've been kind of focused on recently is looking at how we can connect our models and our data to existing databases, existing resources relating to embodied carbon. How we can kind of better quantify this. And part of this engagement has been working with a nonprofit called Building Transparency, which is aggregating all sorts of data on this, which I'll kind of jump to that in a second, but kind of just wanted to give like a brief introduction to how we're beginning to utilize this data that's out there. And so really what this example that I'm going to talk about is getting at is, you know, designers need to be more than just users and consumers of software and data. We need to be actively contributing and are providing. But we need to, at the bare minimum, know how to engage in discussions with the people. This can be any, you know, this isn't necessarily only, you know, apply to the Autodesks of the world. You know, this also applies to kind of small open source projects that are perhaps easier for a typical kind of an architect with some tech skills to be able to contribute to and give feedback to. So this is kind of a spectrum of some of the companies that Walter P. Moore meets with on either kind of like different bases. Some of these we might meet with the developers on like a, you know, a couple times a year. Some of them might be more frequently. Some of them we might be contributing to code and their open source databases. So it really kind of, there's a big spectrum of ways in which we can communicate and give back. So the one, like I mentioned, the one I'll talk about is Building Transparency. So they are, they've been developing a database called EC3, which is stands for embodied carbon. And really what that what this database is doing is it's aggregating EPDs, which are environmental product declarations from all different manufacturers of different building products and materials, and allowing that to exist in one space where people can begin to query the data and compare options in a way that doesn't really currently exist, at least very well. And so this is just a little bit about how we interact with them. Myself and a few others like meet with their developer and their kind of head of the nonprofit biweekly, and kind of give feedback as to the tools they're developing, like improvements they can make to the interface and the database, and what kind of data is valuable to us. And they're super, super like interesting and fruitful conversations that come out of this. And so, you know, if any of you are familiar with like EPDs, typically, you know, and this is kind of what it would look like. You if you think about like ingredients on a box of cereal, this is kind of your ingredients as far as the environmental impact of your kind of your building and material, in this case like a concrete mix. If you imagine there's thousands and tens of thousands of different concrete mixes just in the US alone, so if you needed to compare some different options through PDFs, that's not really a feasible approach. So if the real value, so you can go to their database and get this PDF and access all this information, which is great. But what's even better is that you can, they aggregate all the database in a way that is able to be input into a database and can be queried. So this is just a portion of all that information that you were seeing, but in a JSON format, so that you can actually begin to leverage this data and compare different options and know where the concrete's coming from and begin to calculate, you know, the distance that it's traveling and get like a really, really accurate representation of what the impact of that material is going to be if you decide to use it. And so here's just kind of an example of us connecting this to a project. This is like basically connecting this to our Revit model and then hooking it up to their database and being able to specify particular mixes and look up a mix that would make sense for the building location and try to specify a radius from the site and whatnot. And you can then kind of from what we did from there is develop some of our own in-house tools that leverage, other kind of cloud source lightweight databases such as Airtable to apply kind of our own data on top of what we're getting from EC3 in order to kind of develop a really rich model that we can then create data visualizations from and begin to quantify in more kind of nuanced ways. And then really kind of applying this information to real world projects. So here's an example from a couple of years ago of the Oracle Waterfront Campus in Austin, Texas, where we were looking at, by just having a more informed decision on the concrete mix, being able to say on the upper corner here, you're kind of seeing what would typically be used on this type of project as far as the concrete mixes that would be specified. But with a more informed decision and with the data that's accessible, we're really able to kind of, help reduce the impact of this building from a embodied carbon standpoint quite significantly. And just another, I'm not gonna kind of go through Tally, which is another tool out there for that gets at LCA's life cycle assessments. But it's another great tool that's out there that is built on top of another database that's called Gabby, which is kind of similar to what EC3 is building, but a little bit, it's not necessarily particular to the building industry. But anyway, Tally is kind of getting data from that. And they're also, they actually recently are looking at integrations with EC3 as well. So our enclosures team has worked, and our structures team have worked with Tally as well and collaborated with the people that are building the tools at Kieran Timberlake for this and giving feedback as to how we can leverage it and how to make it better for everyone else in the industry, So here's just kind of, I'll just kind of jump through a quick example here of how we've leveraged that tool to compare, different design options for an enclosure in this particular case, and understanding, the breakdown of the different materials and their impacts. So kind of the second bit that I wanted to get to was delivering with data. So as the producers of vast amounts of data, designers need to consider new ways of leveraging this data beyond traditional architectural design services. So kind of, what I was getting at earlier when I started is like, we really need to think beyond just the idea that we deliver, drawings. So there are these like kind of these notions that have existed in the industry for a while. We create drawings, our models need to be accurate enough to produce drawings, they're sharing information is risky, we design buildings, but really we need to rethink this. So, you know, we don't really create drawings, we create data. Our models really, if we want to help expand our scope and make something more useful, our models need to be machine readable and fabrication friendly. Not sharing information is risky. And we really, we don't design, you know, we really need to start thinking about things as systems. We're not really just designing a static building that's fixed and in particular time. If you think about, you know, there's so much that happens before a building is built, and there's so much that happens after a building is gone. And these are things that architects need to be involved in. And we have the data to be involved in, and the skills and the, and, you know, I think there's, this is really kind of the big opportunity that I think this last point is kind of really where I see a ton of opportunity for architects to really expand their scope. So, you know, this just kind of walks through the typical kind of data loss that would happen on a project. So you know, you might, on a big complex project, you might spend years making this awesome model, then you dumb it down to a series of construction documents, you pass it off to a builder, they're going to look at it, have to ask you a bunch of questions, then they're going to rebuild their own model, and from that model, they're going to make their own shop drawings, and then they're going to give you the shop drawings, and you're going to review it, and it just cycles all the way through construction, and it's just like a ridiculous process. So kind of a better way in which we can do this is to think about, you know, we can make these models and be getting input from the builders and the fabricators while we're doing this, and make that model, you know, really valuable and input the metadata that they need. And that's something that they would pay for. And this is a service that is something that architects can begin to include. And, you know, even in that case, you can then, from that model, they can, you know, produce their shop drawings. If we were to take this even a step further, if we really think about, even on a typical project, not like a prefab, like you're, you know, sending a module to a job site kind of project, it's just a typical project, many of the building components that we are building today are already using CNC processes and have been for decades in many cases. So think about things like cabinetry, ductwork, aluminum framing, extrusions, light gauge framing, rebar shearing, steel cut, like all these things are on lots, pretty much at least one or two of these things are going to be on any typical project. So machines are already building our buildings to a certain degree, and it's only going to continue to be more. That's like a whole nother lecture, but we'll kind of run with that assumption for now. So you would never kind of give a set of 2D drawings to a machine to build. You would, you know, obviously you want to give it a model that has, that's built on top of data. So one of the things that we've really found a lot of leverage in terms of projects and just helping speed up the delivery process is we have an in-house construction engineering team, which the structures and enclosures groups works very closely with them to produce, that we hand off our models. So we're not dumbing down our models into drawings and then having people rebuild them from the drawings. We're really just we're building rigorous models that are accurate and we have confidence in, and we're passing it off to them to produce construction level fabrication ready models that are going straight to the manufacturers and fabricators. Here's just like another example. We do something similar with rebar. In a lot of cases, this is, you know, they're able to use this to cut all the rebar to size by machine, you know, based on the original models. And what you kind of see here is also just kind of a little tangent is a web viewer. So one of the things that we've leveraged also is the ability to, you know, communicate our models and all our metadata and information through a web viewer that's customized to allow people like subcontractors who might not be, you know, they might not know Revit or might not know the software that we're commonly familiar with, but they can come in here and have a much quicker kind of understanding of the building and the schedule than they would have just, you know, which would, it could take them hours to kind of flip through construction documents to understand this. And then kind of the last bit I wanted to quickly run through is, you know, a lot of what I'm talking about as far as the data that's building up our models, these are not new ideas. You know, the sort of origins of BIM go back to like the 1970s. This is kind of a screenshot from like one of the first, you know, quote unquote BIM softwares, which is Glide. And you can kind of see here, without knowing code, you can understand a little bit just by looking at this, that, you know, you can define the spiral staircase by setting something like, you know, the number of steps and the radius and all that kind of stuff. And this is really the same way in which our software today, if you're using a BIM software like Revit, it's really the same thing in the background that's happening. You know, you're defining a center and a radius and giving it, you know, the angle. And when you're communicating this, you know, would you rather have, you know, the rules to make that stair in this case, or would you rather have a, you know, a set of 2D drawings like the one you see on the right, which define, you know, hundreds of dimensions and angles and everything. What I'm arguing here is like the data, the function that builds this piece of geometry is actually much, much simpler in a way than the, you know, a 2D cut through this complex, you know, somewhat complex geometry. And that doesn't necessarily mean you have to know code to understand that. You just have to, you know, understand that how to look at a model, and, you know, you would, the model really in this case, you know, as we're building up models, the models are really just artifacts of the data that we're collecting whenever we're building models and passing them along. So, you know, the model is a visual, it's an artifact of what is really important, which is like kind of the rules in which define this kind of thing. But when we do need to kind of put things on paper, we can begin to think a little bit more, you know, be a little bit more clever with how we do that. So here's an example from Golden State Warriors Arena, where the team, this is a project that our enclosures team was involved in, where they were developing kind of, they needed to, ultimately, they at the end of the day, they were able to pass along the models themselves, but they needed to originally, we're trying to communicate this through 2D drawings and allow people to like rebuild it based on, you know, 2D sets of drawings. So this is a picture of the completed building. So you can see there's all these sort of angled, like oval shapes. So something that would, you know, not lend itself well towards typical orthogonal kind of 2D drawings. And so they were developing these ways in which they were communicating the rules that define this geometry so that somebody can rebuild it, so that a fabricator can accurately rebuild it and not have to be kind of taking these 2D cuts where they're forced to do like approximations of like XYZ values and things like that. And so here's just like another example of that, and another kind of image from that project. But the kind of point that I'm trying to get at with here was this is a project where they were really just kind of brought on as the enclosure engineer, and we're supposed to figure out the enclosure. But because the model was really kind of rigorous and they had a really accurate representation and were confident in that model, we were able to expand their scope and become a much larger player on this project. Just by having the data there in an accurate model. So just like another small example I wanted to show in regards to that. And then just to kind of conclude, I think that, you know, I think there's a lot of talk about kind of like the demise of architecture and all this that's happening right now. And I want to kind of put a optimistic spin on it. I think there's actually a ton of opportunity. You know, I think data can liberate architects from limiting themselves to the designers of static objects with defined boundaries. And architects should be asking how their data can connect to and improve things beyond our typical scope, such as supply chains and building operations. And you know, the ability of designers to better predict performance is an opportunity for us to take on more risk and become more relevant stakeholders. You know, this kind of, you know, flirts with things related to like simulation and you know, analysis that I haven't touched on, but I think you guys are all kind of familiar with that kind of how this relates to that. And then simply, you know, more accurate data will open doors for more scope. So I think there is, you know, if we embrace this opportunity right now. I think there's actually, when I say embrace this opportunity in terms of like the data is there, like we just need to be confident in it and run with it and really learn how to communicate and deliver with it. So I'll leave it at that.
Great. Should I take over?
Yep.
Awesome. All right. Thank you so much, Jared, because I feel like we were meant to present together. I'm going to go on a continuation of the spiel, which very directly is going to be just please join Spatial Tech. This is going to be me on my soapbox for a little bit, which many of you, if you know me, won't be surprised about. So we've seen a bunch of emergence of spatial technology where spatial designers, I think, are really needed. So things like prop tech like Zillow, but also co-working and Airbnbs and sidewalk labs. And there's all these different disciplines that are really associated with spatial tech. So when you're thinking about your own career, I think also recognize that from an architecture or an urban design background, there are all these other paths that are really related. So things like looking at spatial behavior could be in the realm of interaction design or social factors that have to do with physical space. That could be design computation, so things like digital fabrication or generative design. Things in the realm of data visualization, so data journalism, spatial analysis, or process and project management around spatial aspects, so like tools for communication on a construction site. So there's all these different realms where spatial expertise is needed. But it's not just prop tech and Airbnb that are changing cities, not just like architecture and engineering and construction. There's a lot of major implications for urban designers and planners because cities are totally being reshaped right now by companies like this. And I'd argue that they're actually having a more drastic impact on cities than any of the physical inventions in the last century. So just to hone this point in more, I find this GIF funny, but also slightly terrifying. Even Tinder's matching algorithm is leading to more marriages each year as more matches are made, which means that ultimately the matching algorithm is gonna shape the genetic makeup of the human race. So if you change that algorithm and who you match, you're actually changing the genetic makeup. The filters of Yelp actually dictate what someone sees. So they literally filter the makeup of where people go in different zones. Something like StreetEasy or Zillow, if you check a box that says elevator building or yada yada, that's actually can change the makeup of where people live. So it choreographs people into different districts throughout a city. And when a recommendation engine on one of these sites reinforce a user's preferences, we start to see spatial filter bubbles. So we all know like the filter bubble from a recommendation engine related to things like advertising, but these aren't just non-physical things. So if you have a recommendation engine that tells you to go certain places, you're propagating those same filter bubbles, but now in physical space. So in my class, Data Mining the City at GSAPP, we try and think not just about the walls, infrastructure, three dimensions at a physical moment in time, which is really like what Rhino is focused on modeling, but some of these invisible aspects like behavior, time, movement, policy, growth, and interaction. So how do we understand and model things like movement or how things react to physical space? So this was a student project that was looking at how a change in the UI of a ride app impacts the waiting times in physical space. So there's actually a connection between what you do in a UI and what happens in physical space in aggregate. So technology can't just think about the user experience, about the one individual experience, because in aggregate, there's actually, there's a social experience. There's an impact in aggregate. When many people do the same thing at once, you actually get emergent properties, sometimes at a societal level. Even if you think about some of the revolutions that were caused by a Facebook page. This was looking at the design of looking at the design of autonomous vehicles, and so looking at capacities and how that impacts the movement across the city. This student was looking at infection spread rate in Manhattan based on the physical characteristics of the city and where open space was. Ironically, it's almost like too real. This was before the COVID pandemic. And then this student was really looking at pedestrian routes on a street network based on changing the amount of time that someone would stroll or walk fast. So I'm trying to understand movement based on the physical characteristics. This student was looking at Google's walk path, how Google's walk path could change the flows in a city if you actually changed that, the directions that you put into Google. So usually when you say you want to go somewhere, it's just a shortest path algorithm. But this was looking at what would happen if you change that to optimize for walking past nature or where there's activity. And then what does that actually do to the experience of a city if you change that? But spatial designers, I don't think they're not only needed for those kind of city scale problems. We're on a Zoom call right now. And there's like this whole world behind me and probably behind you, and you probably totally forgot that you were like even sitting in a space. And I'd argue that, you know, maybe we have these like dumb, flat 2D computers and we do all of our interaction on here while ignoring the rest of our space. We don't have spatial interactions. Maybe because we didn't have spatial designers working on these problems. Maybe the computer needs some more spatial thinkers to think about telecommunication. So in Measuring the Great Indoors, I co-teach this class with Gabby Brainerd. We have architects and urban design students try and investigate the spatial, intangible, and impromptu potential of web connectivity. So really thinking about how to heighten the connection both between people, but also with the physical world, with digital interactions that don't happen just on the screen. They happen in physical space. So students hack together smart home products, cameras, projectors with this microservice called If This Then That, which allows you to create routines where these different smart home products speak to one another. So designers can come up with all kinds of recipes. This is some of the cards we used to prototype these recipes. They're in this If This Then That structure. So it's almost like a simple language. So we used these simple sentence structures to prototype some recipes and name them. I'll just let you read some. And so in this class, we're again not trying to think just about the user interface, but really about the spatial interface. So what is the interaction with physical space, not just the phone or the computer? So this student was interested in what it would look like for a smart home system like Amazon to have a much stronger personality. So he made this prototype of a pushy smart home system that would try and get you to open the window if the weather was nice outside. So it would detect the temperature outside and then try and get you to go for it. The student produced an airbag that forced brakes after you'd been at your computer too long. This was this past semester, so we spent a lot of time indoors in the quarantine. This student synced up their light to shut off every time the train passed by the window. So actually syncing up the lighting with the train schedule. This was an immersive projection that made you feel like you're riding on a train from the comfort of your home. So let me just... So it's really focused on much more immersive environments than something that's contained in a screen. So again, not the user experience, but really the spatial experience and the social experience. So usually this next portion, I'll talk a little bit about interactions that are between many people. So I think one of the things that's kind of funny is that most applications are really built for an individual. A computer is built for an individual. So how do we actually create social experiences? Architects and designers are really well suited to think about more social and spatial applications of interfaces. So Wenya was really interested in the governance and voting behind aspects like turning on a light or changing a thermostat. So when you're with a group of people, how do you decide whether a light is turned on or off? Usually it's just like whoever is closest to the light bulb. And how do you decide where to set the temperature? When I was at GSAPP, it was always an argument with whoever sat next to the, the temperature or the thermostat. So she used moods of people in the room to change the lighting environment. So if someone would get upset, then the light would change. So you see how there's a governance in that. Like you have to make a decision about how many people need to be sad in order for the light to change. There's all these kind of implications of what does it mean when multiple people are the user of something, of a technology. This project was called Haikus for the Great Indoors. It was a smart home bot, which turns on participants' lights to read a haiku. So it's like a bot haiku. And anytime another participant in another space turned their light off. So there are three students, they're in multiple cities, and anytime one of them would turn their light off, everyone else's light would turn off and they'd be read this haiku about the great indoors. Just all kind of quarantine related, getting them tapped in.
Particularly warm walls, empty walls, rugs, warm table through the A.
Particularly warm walls, empty walls, rugs, warm table through the A.
Particularly warm walls, empty walls, rugs, warm table through the A.
This always plays twice.
Particularly warm walls, empty walls, rugs, warm table through the A.
Which I always think is a ghost in the machine. All right. And finally, synchronized wallpaper was a projected wallpaper that updates whenever anyone leaves or enters a webcam frame. So it's supposed to serve as a visual reminder and a connector to the constant activities that were happening even during COVID's like largely isolated activities. So again, these are students across the world in the same class, but they have this wallpaper that changes to be the same color when they're, it changes anytime someone leaves their screen. So our interactions are really spatial. Even if we're sitting in front of a computer or Zoom, we're still somewhere. And we're with someone or not with someone. We're in a room, we're in a house, we're in a neighborhood. And if we don't have spatial designers thinking about that, then how are we supposed to really design for modern day technology? We might end up with things like this, and where all of our interactions happen in this. So we really need to think about how those interact our social and spatial environments. So hopefully this has convinced you to please join spatial tech. I also realized I copied a bunch of these slides in from another presentation, and I didn't credit each one of the students from the previous slide. So I might just send you some names so that they're included when you post the video. All righty, that's it, folks. Do it.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for sharing, both Violet and Jared. Are there any questions from our gallery of participants here? Nora, if this sounds like, oh no, your camera turned on. I'm sorry to put you on the spot. Okay, well, why don't I just, what time is it? I'll ask one maybe for both of you. I guess as you develop these new sort of technologies, whether it's Jared's sort of, you know, the technologies that you're developing is training people to, like, contractors or clients to think a certain way or to work a certain way. Or I guess Violet, when you're working with students and in the work that you do yourself, sort of like training people to use your technology in a different way, to train people to use existing technologies in like thinking of them in a different way. I wonder if there's moments where like the user themselves would radically change the original desires or intent of the project in a way that the user is more engaged directly, rather than being trained or being taught a certain process. I mean, it seems like, of course, maybe for client side purposes, it seems maybe a little bit more difficult, but as you're starting to develop these super interesting and kind of very immersive ways of working.
Yeah, actually one of the reasons that I think, this class I co-teach with Gabby Brainerd, one thing that's so interesting about that kind of technology is that it's based on these microservices, like if this and that, where it doesn't require, it really doesn't require software engineering knowledge in order to use. It's like, it's language, really simple language based. So it's like, if the temperature drops, then turn a fan on. That's the kind of way you set up these recipes or these programs. sorry, my dog is really excited. I don't know if you can hear her, but she's very excited. Okay. So I think it's really interesting that you can actually start to have end user programming. So you don't even need to be the designer in order to create something that's going to change this immersive environment. Let's say like I live somewhere and a programming environment has been set up where I can make my own recipes. So this is like kind of already starting in smart home products, like they'll let you set up kind of dumb little recipes. I think they're pretty gimmicky. Like they don't really do much, but I do think there's like a whole potential there where you don't have to like train someone, this is how you do a thing. Like they actually it's simple enough that they can program or like create the environment themselves.
Yeah, I guess I would say similarly, like if you make it easy to use, it's you know, it's trivial, you know, especially, and that's not, you know, that's not a hard thing to do in the architecture industry when our processes that have been traditionally so slow and, you know, convoluted, to make it easier for someone to absorb information is actually not that hard in a way. So yeah, like a lot of times it's just a matter of making something easier for someone, and then you don't really need to worry about the training side so much.
I have a question. Thank you. First, thank you for the lecture. It was a great last one. Sad that it's going to be over. A question to Jared, when you presented when you were saying that there's databases where they're designed in order for the architects to sort of have a set of a place where you can refer to a kind of like material or building specifications in order to, for example, be more aware about the kind of material you're picking. And I guess like the question is, who would design these databases, and could there be a bias embedded when designing such a database, specifically that knowing that, for instance, it implies that this requires like a great knowledge in the context that we're working in. So yeah, that's the
question. Yeah, no, that's a great question. I think so. In that particular example, so. In the case of like EC3, that I think a lot of the input that they're getting into that database is coming from manufacturers. And so the discussions that we have with them are coming at it from a design standpoint. And because of that, like we're able to provide feedback to them as like, well, how do you make this more useful for us? Is really kind of like the key to the discussions that we're having with them. So I think like for the people that are developing the databases, it's really important to have these discussions with not, you know, within, if we're talking about with just within the AEC industry, you know, have discussions with manufacturers, with contractors, with architects, with engineers. It's really important to have a lot of people that you're getting feedback from. I mean, you would do that on like a software product. You would get feedback from different types of users and to better understand like how to make it the most flexible. So yeah, and I guess even more specifically, so the woman who's kind of spearheading that charge, she Stacy Smedley at Building Transparency, she's coming from like a contractor standpoint. So it's always like really interesting. She actually has like, I think she has like an architecture background and then has been working for Skanska and like is coming at it from there. So like it's really interesting to kind of, She's like in a really good spot because she has both the architecture and like contracting experience to speak to that. And so when you get people that have these different backgrounds, I think it's really valuable to leverage all that kind of a mix of knowledge.
Yeah, I guess it's like that kind of touches on the idea of like proprietary design. Like if the sort of technology and the sort of data sets, you know, who has access, who's able to have access to it. And I guess as a designer, like providing, you know, whether it's providing the interface for people to understand a logic, like if this, then that, or if you're actually sort of going to the back end or wherever to sort of provide the knowledge and to sort of construct these frameworks is sort of where people can sort of position themselves in various places as you move through design and architecture and of course technology in those areas. But unless anybody else have a question or a comment, this would probably just wrap up our very last Techno-Critical Assemblies, and miraculously on time for once. So thank you everyone, especially Jared and Violet. Projects honestly look amazing. I'm so glad to have time to see some of them more directly. And everyone else, I wish you a good finals week. Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Thank you.